The following program is a television outreach of Whole Life and Sandra Kennedy Ministries in Augusta, Georgia, and is sponsored in part by our friends and partners for life from around the world.
Call those things that be not as though they were, and watch dead things come to life again. This is Sandra Kennedy, pastor of Whole Life Ministries in Augusta, Georgia. Oh, my goodness gracious. We love it when we hear from you. Thank you for all your fine, wonderful comments that you send to us on as you follow us on Facebook, and then as you watch us on YouTube and all those different things around there. And some of you are even following us every Sunday morning live on our internet. I'm telling you, God's doing so many things. We just rejoice in it. The message today, I'm telling you, we are talking about healing. It's your call. Now, we're trying to bring you up to date and help you understand some things. God's still in the healing business. I want you to know that. He loves you. He's not mad with you. He's still powerfully preaching healing. And we're seeing healing take place everywhere. When we come around areas doing healing explosions, we've told you about them. We'll come to your area. We just see people just fall in love with Jesus and just take what God has already given them. It's exciting. Very, very exciting. You'll love the message. I promised you healing. It is your call.
Okay, church, get your Bibles and let's go over to Mark chapter 5. We're going to continue teaching about healing. Many of you don't know, as you watch across the nation, and when we talk about healing explosions that we do here in Augusta, Georgia, or where we travel across the nation doing healing explosions, some of you don't even know what we're talking about. We're actually go in and we teach you the word of the Lord to get you to fall so in love with Jesus that you don't have to beg him for anything. We help you understand that he has already done it for you. Healing is a part of the atonement, a plan of redemption. We take the word of God, let the word of God stand on its own two feet, and we show you in the word what your God has done for you. And you know, 60% is about the smallest number of people who come to get healed that get healed. And we've had as many up to 95%, almost 100%. It has been unbelievable. These are people who tell us they're healed. That's not me telling anybody they're healed. That's them. Of course, I'm quoting the word of the Lord, and he says they're healed. And I let them decide whether they're going to believe the word of God or not. But it's very exciting. We have a healing center where they come from all over the world, every state in the union, to come to be a part of it. It's here for you. Go to sandrakennedy.org. Keep up with us and invite us to your area, and we'll be happy to come. And again, you can see where we are in many different areas around the nation. It's exciting what God's doing. This is the greatest hour for the church, and we're excited about it. Now, I'm going to take you again, and we're going to look at Mark chapter 5, and then we'll go over to Matthew 8. And I'm going to show you in the Word of God something that to me is, when I think about it, I teach it practically everywhere I go, but it's, every time I think about it, it's just so unbelievable to be so wonderful that God would let you and I decide, even lay the groundwork, how we want to be healed. And the Word proves that out. And that's what I'm going to show you. The main thing is that healing is in the atonement. Healing is in the plan of redemption. God wants you well. It belongs to you. Now, again, we're just talking about what your God has provided for you already. We don't beg. We're not crying. We're not pleading. We are praising the Lord because he has done what he said he will do. I need a few more praising the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. For what God has done. So over in the 5th chapter of Mark, there are two stories that relate to each other right there. And you've got, I'm going to talk to you about three people in the Bible, two men and one woman. And one is a ruler of a synagogue. One is a centurion who's a Gentile and who is not, means not a Jew. And the other one is a Jewish woman. And all three of them make their own decision about how they want to be healed. Now, I could teach, an hour or two on each one of these individually. So I'm going to try to throw them together for you here just to whet your appetite so that you'll see how wonderful Jesus is. I mean, he is outstanding. and He loves you. He's not mad with you. He is on your side. He's a good God, and I don't care what you've done or where you've been. God's bigger than anything you've ever done. The blood will go anywhere if you'll reach out to Him and come running to Him. He loves you so much. He's so outstanding. And I'm telling you, the greatest weapon against the devil you have is praise, and just praise Him. So in the fifth chapter of Mark, we start off with a guy who, in the 22nd verse, named Jairus. And Jairus, he's a ruler of the synagogue. So now put this in order. He's a ruler of the synagogue. He shouldn't even be coming. He could be kicked out of the synagogue for coming to Jesus. You do know the crowd didn't like Jesus. You understand that? I'm talking about the synagogue crowd, basically, the rulers of it. Scribes and the Pharisees and the Sadducees and folks of that nature. I mean, Jesus was not their favorite hometown fellow, if anybody remembers that. So Jairus obviously had heard about Jesus. Now, let me remind you, if you can get somebody to really listen, if you can get somebody to really hear past their outside ears and hear with their spirit man, because you are a spirit, you have a soul, your mind, your will, your emotions, and you live inside of a body. And if I can get you to hear with the spirit and get you to really understand what Jesus has done for you, what His word proclaims for you, and the integrity of the word of the Lord, we can get you healed. The problem is most of us get in agreement with God. I mean, we just get in agreement with what we've heard, and yet we have not settled it inside of us that the word, if He said it, He will do it. So we're talking about the integrity of the word of God. You've got to make up your mind what the Bible really means to you. And we're going to let the Word do its own thing. Many ways to get healed. I mean, you can lay handkerchiefs. I mean, lay handkerchiefs on folks where you can. I tell people to wear them. The handkerchiefs that's been prayed over, lay hands on folks. I mean, all tons of ways. But to get the Word inside of you straight from the Bible yourself is the most powerful way. When you fall in love with Jesus and you take Him at His Word, be it unto you according to His word. So Jairus comes, and it says, again, I'm in the fifth chapter of Mark, and it says that he has a daughter at home. His daughter basically is dying, and he asked Jesus to come go home with him. Jesus is in the downtown square, hallelujah, and he's down there, a mob is around him, and Jairus comes to him and say, will you go home with me, basically, and lay your hands upon my daughter, and when you do, she will be healed. Now, I want you to notice that he's the one who gave that method for his daughter to be healed. I want to also remind you that, look at verse 22. Behold, there cometh one by the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. When he saw him, he fell at his feet and besought him greatly, saying, my little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay your hands on her, that she may be healed, and she shall live. So he had already made up his mind. He was the authority over this daughter. He had made his mind up, if I can get Jesus to go home with me, let him lay hands on her. He had already decided, just Jesus laying hands on her, she will be healed. He didn't put a question mark in there. He didn't say, maybe she will. He didn't say, you know, there's a possibility that she might be healed. I'm not really sure, but I don't have anything else going for me at the moment. If you'll just come try this out, possibly something will happen. No, he was very direct. He said, if you will come home, my daughter's almost dead. If you will come home, if you will lay your hands, he's telling Jesus what to do now. You come, you lay your hands on her, she will live. Anybody listening? Now, Jesus is so wonderful. Jesus didn't say, well, I can just say something and I don't even have to go there. He says, okay, I'll do exactly what you ask. So he's on his way following Jairus. In a big mob, there's a woman at home watching Fox News. And as she is watching Fox News or wherever she is, she's not watching one of the news channels. She's heard about Jesus. What did she hear? He is a healer. He's in the healing business. She heard about him. She had an issue of blood for 12 years. She made up her mind. She says, if I can get to where Jesus is, if I can just get there without anybody stopping me before I get there, because if I'm caught, I can be stoned. That's what the law said. She didn't have a right to mix and mingle with folks. She had no right to be in the crowd. She took a risk. I'm telling you, you better get desperate about your healing. And so she says, if I can get there and I can touch just the fringe of his tallit, the blue, the fringe of his tallit, if I can but touch it, I will be made whole. She decided, I don't need him to lay hands on me. I don't need a handkerchief. I don't need anything. I don't need him to even talk to me. Matter of fact, I want to sneak up. I just want to do my little thing that I have decided here. If I can but touch the hem, the fringe, it really was, of his tallit, if I can but touch it, I will be healed. So she decided how she wanted to be healed. Now, again, I want you to notice the first guy, when he came, Jairus could have been thrown out of the synagogue because, again, they were not in favor of Jesus.
Right.
And then here's the second woman who had an issue of blood, had spent all of her money with every doctor that she had ever been to. Thank God for doctors. Don't misunderstand me. But the doctors had done everything the doctor could do. And she, every dime she had, she had spent. She had no more money. She had nowhere to go. She heard about Jesus, and it was worth taking a risk. I wish somebody would.
Hallelujah.
And she says, if I can get to him, what I heard, listen to me, she made her mind up, I believe what I heard. If she didn't believe it, she would not have come out. That's right. People hear about the healing center here. They hear about all the people that are being healed. And we're talking about, we've seen thousands of people healed. The medical profession refer people to us. We go into about 16 hospitals around here. And we go in and we've seen, so many people just, it's unbelievable. Doctors call us, nurses call us, paramedics call us. And we go, we've seen things happen that are unbelievable around us. They heard what God was doing and they made their way. I have got to get there. Now, we work hand in glove with the medical profession, and we thank God for the medical profession because we believe they're trying to do what we're trying to do is get people well. Hallelujah. But God intended for us. He didn't intend for us, and we all go die one day, but he didn't intend for us to be eaten up with diseases because I read my Bible in Deuteronomy 28, verses 1 through 14, and it says, if I am obedient, and I do, and follow the commandments of the Lord, he will take all these diseases away from me. Hallelujah. And so that's what he said. And then he said from Deuteronomy 15 all the way to 60-something, you got all the curses. And I read over there in Galatians, and Galatians said, hallelujah, that he took the curse for me. So therefore, I am not cursed.
Amen.
Look at your neighbor. Say, I am not cursed. I do not live under a curse. I am not cursed. Hallelujah. And the Bible says that sickness is a part of the curse. And that's just the way it is. Now, and then we come down, and so this woman makes up her mind. She says, if I can just, I've got to, she said it. She said what she believed. She said what she believed. Then it's one thing to say it. It's another thing to get up and do it. It wouldn't have done her one ounce of good to sit at home, not one ounce of good to sit at home and just watch the TV and say, I believe that, I believe that, I believe that. She had to get up and go to where Jesus was. Are you with me? She had to get up and she had to go to where he was. She had to risk, if they catch me, they can stone me. I want to remind you that Jesus is walking with a ruler of the synagogue who had the power to stone her. We overlooked that many times. And so here she comes, sneaking through the crowd. All right, if I can just sneak in, and I can crawl through, can't let anybody see me, can't let anything, and if I can just touch this, I'll be gone, but I'll be healed. Because she had made up her mind.
Yes.
I will be healed because I'm going to receive that anointing that I know is upon him. I'm going to take it. I know it's all over him. It's mine, and I'm going to risk it because I'm going to die anyway if I can't get to him. Anybody listening? Hallelujah. So she gets on her way. She does exactly what she said she was going to do. And guess what? It happened just exactly like she said. The first one said, Jairus said, go to my house, lay hand on my child, and my child will be healed. The woman with issue of blood says, I don't have to touch me, don't have to say nothing to me, don't have to do nothing. I'm going to sneak in there, and I'm going to touch the hem of your garment, and I will be healed. And both of them got it exactly the way they said it. Now, the thing that's interesting in all of this to me that is so very interesting is that here Jairus, of course, is walking with Jesus. He'd already said his daughter was about dead. So he's walking, going to his daughter's house, and here comes this woman touches Jesus. Now, I really don't think that Jairus saw her do this, because it was Jesus who stopped.
That's right.
Jesus stopped and said, "Somebody touched me." You remember?
Yeah.
Said, "Somebody touched me." And then, you know, somebody put a demand on my power. Somebody put a demand on the power that's inside of me. Somebody touched me differently than this mob has touched me.
Amen.
This mob has been reaching out. This mob has been touching me. This mob has been here. They're all yelling and screaming and hollering and probably wondering if I'm gonna, you know, produce some more food, or if I'm going to feed them or clothe them or whatever I'm going to do. And so they were just around, just kind of looking at this guy, thinking, who is this guy, and just whatever. But there was one woman in there that said, "I'm coming after. I know this man has healing power. I'm coming after that power that's in him. I believe that he has that God-given healing power in him. I've heard what he has done. And you, if you want some fish, go get your fish. But I want to be healed." Hallelujah. Because the crowd that got all the fish and stuff, I mean, I'm not knocking the fish. I can't turn no fish, make no fish turn into more fish, and neither can you. But they didn't show up, and they were not steady. They didn't stay there. Hello. Crowds followed him everywhere as long as they could get some kind of little goodies or get their little bellies full. But they didn't stay with him. Anybody listening?
Amen.
So this woman comes, and then Jesus has the audacity to ask the question, "Who touched me?" His disciples thought he'd lost his mind, just like you would have thought that too. "What do you mean, who touched you? What is the matter with you? Everybody's touching you." I mean, people are everywhere. We're trying to keep them away. The security team's not doing good. They're all around me. They're getting to you everywhere. They're reaching through. They're touching you. But they were just touching so they could go back and said, I touched Jesus. I touched the rabbi. I touched that new little rabbi from Nazareth. I touched him. Hallelujah." But she had a whole different purpose. She'd made her mind up. "I'm going to get what this man has." Hallelujah. "And he can change and transform my life forever.
Amen.
And so you remember, the whole show stops. Everything stops. Jairus right in the middle. And Jesus said, "Who touched me?" "Somebody touched me. And I felt the power go out." Which, by the way, let me say to you, this is the only story in the entire New Testament where Jesus felt anything go out of him. And it's the only place in the entire New Testament where somebody he prayed for felt something come into him. So why is it that we have to feel something when somebody prays for us?
Right.
How many times have I prayed for somebody and they say, "I don't guess I got it. Didn't feel nothing." Hallelujah.
Right.
Well, this is the only one out of all the hundreds of thousands that Jesus touched that said they felt anything.
Uh-huh. Well,
hello? Amen. It's the only place where he said he felt something go out of him.
Well,
is anybody listening?
Yes.
Now, so here we go. Now, what if you were Jairus? What are you doing? We're on our way. My daughter's dying. But and this next part, I don't even know if I'll get to the third person. Who knows? But this because this is so fascinating to me. Here he is. The woman finally acknowledges. She comes and says, "I'm the one who touched you. I'm the one." And then Jesus said to her, "Daughter, thy faith has made thee whole. Go in peace, and be healed of thy plague. Don't suffer anymore. You're totally healed. You're made totally and completely whole. Go your way. Hallelujah. You got what you came for, girl. Hallelujah. Go in it. Rejoice in it." And instantaneously, that issue of blood dried up instantly. And she walked away totally, completely healed, because she wanted it bad enough. She didn't care what anybody said. She went against the norm. She went against the public. She went against what all her friends thought. She went against what everybody else thought. They ridiculed her. They came against her. They thought she was stupid and crazy, but she got it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. She got it. She got it. And a lot of you are members of churches where we don't believe in healing. Well, they must not believe in the Bible. The Bible teaches healing. Hallelujah. You better get with some folks who believe the Word of God, because we can't water it down. Jesus went around doing three things: teaching, preaching, healing. And if your church, they're only teaching and preaching, they're only doing two parts of the three-part gospel: teaching, preaching, healing. And everybody ought to have a bottle of oil sitting around. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Let me get off of that. All right, now, so here's Jairus. And Jesus sends her on the way. And while they're standing there, here the servants come up to Jairus. I just love this. Verse 35. And while Jesus was speaking to the woman, you know, the whole march has stopped. And they're all standing around. He says, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain men which said, your daughter's dead, forget it. I mean, that's my interpretation. Said, your daughter is dead. He said, don't trouble the master anymore. In other words, he was coming. I understand that. She wasn't dead when you left home. She's dead now. But no need to bother him. Just, you know, if he hadn't, you can just imagine Jairus, if you hadn't stopped and prayed for that crazy woman who wasn't even supposed to be out here. Hallelujah. And then, bless God, you had to find her. My daughter is dead. But look what Jesus did. This is such a lesson. And as soon as Jesus heard, he heard the guy speak to Jairus. As soon as he heard Jairus' servant say what they said to him, they said, your daughter is dead. And he said unto the ruler, he said unto Jairus, Jesus turned immediately. He heard what they said to her. He turned immediately to him. And he said to him, he said, don't be afraid. Only believe. He said, don't get in fear. In other words, Jairus, don't say anything. Jairus, keep your mouth shut. I said I was going to your house. I said I'd lay my hand. From God's point of view, Jesus' point of view, nothing has changed. Amen. Is anybody listening? In the natural it had changed, but not in the heart of Jesus. He said, you asked me to come. You asked me to lay hands on her. I'm coming. They say she's dead. I say she's not dead. So who you going to get in agreement with? Jairus, just don't say nothing. Be neutral. Hallelujah. You know, don't agree with the bad report. I love it because you don't ever hear Jairus saying another word. I mean, you don't hear nothing from Jairus anymore. And you know the story. Jesus goes in, he goes to the house, and all of them laugh at him because Jesus says she's just asleep and says, you know, she's not dead. Everybody's mourning and carrying on. They, you know, hollering and yelling and screaming and carrying on. And then they want to yell at Jesus and tell him how crazy he is, so he throws the whole crowd out. That's a good lesson. Don't have it. If somebody's not believing, get them out of the house. Don't let them get around you. Get them away from you. Don't take those unbelievers in with you. If you got the belief and the faith and you standing on the Word of God, God's Word, He said it. He's not a man that He should lie. He will do what He said. I'm back to the integrity of the Word of God. And God's Word, He said, I'm going to your house. I'm going to lay hands on him. And guess what? You're going to get exactly what you said you were going to get, exactly where your faith was. That's what you're going to get. I'm going to walk in that door, go get all those unbelievers out the door, go take in just a couple of my own disciples. We're going to go in, and guess what? He raised her up. Hallelujah! She was healed. Jesus is in the healing business. Of course, the other one has to do with the centurion, the guy who said, you know, I've got a servant at home. You remember that story over in Matthew 8, said, I've got a servant at home, and he didn't even ask, and Jesus said, hey, I'll come to your house. He said, you don't need to come to my house. You don't need to come to my house. I'm a man under authority. All you need to do, and I thank God for some, there are some people under authority. They're few and limited, but there's some. But if they understand, he said, I don't need you to come. I know you're a man under authority, and I know you can't lie. I've watched you. You give the word, and that's all I need. And if you tell me, you give me the word, and you tell me my servant's all right, go and see somebody else who don't have no belief. Hallelujah. I said, or who needs a little more. I don't need anything but your word. I don't need a lightning flash. I don't need a toot toot from Gabriel. I don't need nothing from nobody. I just need Jesus for you to say, you pick up your word and said, by the stripes of Jesus, I am healed. You said you sent your word and healed me. You said it. All I need to hear you say is, he's healed. Go your way. When you get there, you'll be all right. He'll be healed. That is exactly what happened. Yeah. And Jesus said, man, I have never seen anything like this. I marvel. Yeah. Good gracious. He marveled twice in the Bible. He marveled one time. Woo! Have you ever seen anybody with faith like this? Then he marveled, went over in Nazareth, and he said, woo! Have you ever seen a crowd with no faith like this in his own hometown? So I want him marveling because of my faith. Yeah. I want him marveling because I believe the word. I want him marveling because Jesus is still in the healing business. I promise you, he is in the healing business. I'm telling you, come on down here to Augusta, Georgia. I'm telling you, God's doing things right and left. We've been watching it happen for years. And I'm telling you, God is an unchangeable God. He is not a man that he should lie. If he said it, he will do it. He is faithful in any and everything he does.
Yes.
Amen, church.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Did you learn anything?
Yes.
Oh, give him glory and give him praise. He's worthy of all praise and all glory. Hallelujah.
Healing belongs to you. Sandra Kennedy's package, I Sent My Word and Healed Them, includes the CD entitled Words of Life for Healing. 58 minutes of healing scripture ministered by Sandra while original music plays in the background. The book, The Magnificent Word of the Lord, provides healing and other topics for scriptural prayer and explanations of how to apply scripture to your life to see a change in your circumstances. The DVD, I Sent My Word and Healed Them, is a message Sandra taught at Christ for the Nations. This message has gone all over the world and is an amazing presentation of the healing Christ has purchased for you. And as a point of contact to release your faith, 3 prayer cloths are included, imprinted with a special design given to Sandra through a vision, and have personally been anointed and prayed over by Sandra. Order the I Sent My Word and Healed Them package and release the healing power of God in your life today.
If ever you wanted to get a package, you want to get this package, because inside of it, you're going to find the magnificent Word of the Lord, which is a scripture book. Oh, it's different than any you've ever had, ever seen anywhere. And on top of that, it's absolutely beautiful. And again, you also can get, this is a healing explosion that I did a good while ago, but it's just so wonderful. And we got such great results from it. I sent my word and healed them. And again, this Words of Life for Healing has gone all over the world. God supernaturally gave this CD to me. I could never redo it. You'll want to get it. And of course, our healing collection prayer cloths. You want that package, I promise you. Let me remind those of you up in the Pennsylvania area, New York area, wherever you might be, this week, from July the 26th through the 31st, I will be at Blue Mountain Christian Retreat in Ringgold, Pennsylvania. So come see us. We're going to be there all week long teaching on healing. We'd love to have you to come be a part of that. We enjoy it so much when we go up there. And very soon now, I think it's August the 18th or the 19th, I'm going to be in Goldsboro, North Carolina at the Rosewood Worship Center. You can call that number on your screen, find out more about it. We'll be doing a healing explosion there. We'll also be doing a healing explosion at the Blue Mountain Christian Retreat. Oh, we have seen more healings take place up there. It is just, fly in from anywhere and be a part of it. Again, follow us, please, on Facebook. We thank you for that. And I said, continue to watch us on YouTube. Remember, you can watch us live streaming on the Live Net. We archive everything. We'd love for you to partner with us for $20 a month. It'd make all the difference in the world. It's our desire that you're blessed by the messages that come forth to you, because Jesus is a wonderful, miracle-working God.